everybody.
Well, thanks for coming out. The weather has gotten a little chillier. I'm Steve Berman, director of the Center for Global Health, and it's my pleasure to introduce Nee-Kofi, Mould-Millman. Nee-Kofi is an assistant professor in the Department of Emergency Medicine and a senior investigator at the Center for Global Health. And we thought it'd be great to have Nee-Kofi present on campus about the Ebola epidemic from the perspective of someone who has spent a lot of time in Africa emergency services. Last month, he gave another talk on emergency services here. He just got back from Ghana and Tanzania, where we did a pediatrics and disaster course. And I think he has a more kind of holistic, African-centric view on the Ebola crisis and what it's done. And so I really want to thank Nee-Kofi for being willing to share that perspective with us today.
Good morning. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Well, thanks so much, Steve. I really appreciate the introduction and the opportunity to kind of share this story and the evolving outbreak with you all. It's my understanding that there's a pretty sort of diverse group over here, and it may be worthwhile for me just to take a second to get a poll of who's here. So any students, sort of all health-related students, so if you... Good. Any healthcare providers, clinicians, great. And anybody involved in sort of global health work in general, actively? Okay. And then administrators, leaders on campus, and so on. Okay, great. Thank you. That's useful for me to understand that perspective. Good. So I'm going to be spending the next 50 minutes or so talking to you all about, I guess, an issue that's really... featured very prominently in the media over the past seven months or so. And what I hope to do today is sort of twofold. One, to give you a context of some of the sociocultural and healthcare system issues that I think have really played a significant part in evolving this outbreak to the sort of local epidemic that it is. And then secondly, sort of demonstrating some of the priorities in the interventions and the approach to sort of, avoiding this this outbreak. I have no conflicts or disclosures. And like Steve said, I bring maybe a slightly different twist to this. I know there have been, I think, at least two other speakers on campus over the past, I think, 6 weeks. And so part of my perspective as somebody who's really lived in West Africa for over 20 years and who spends weeks to months every year over the last few years actively engaged in research, development, building these systems and understanding what the issues are. A lot of what I do is partner with ministries of health in a few different countries to build really sustainable and effective frontline emergency care systems, both pre-hospitals, ambulance-related systems, motorbike-related systems, community-based responders, and in-hospital emergency care systems. And if you can, as you may know from the current epidemic or the outbreak, I'll demonstrate how Ebola. The outbreak has really been, I think, has really tested or stressed those existing healthcare systems. So we're going to do three things today, in no particular order. But one, I'm going to sort of allow you to understand the pathogenesis and the clinical syndrome of Ebola virus disease. Two, to appreciate some of the sociocultural and the healthcare system factors that have really contributed and magnified the transmission. And three, to allow you to understand and assess the various response strategies in West Africa. And I'm going to do this by telling you a story. Was anybody here in the global health course sort of last week and the week before by chance? You know, so maybe you caught a little bit of this already. And so the story of Ebola really goes back not, you know, a few months ago, but actually 38 years ago. Startling to realize this has been, you know, this has been happening for so long. And actually back then, in then Zaire, now Democratic Republic of Congo and the Sudan, where the WHO was called to track and help investigate a really deadly disease that had affected a couple of communities and was sort of decimating their populations. And so they actually sent a young, recent medical grad who was training as a clinical microbiologist, Peter Payo, and he was actually among the first to help characterize this disease. And what they noticed is the hallmarks were twofold. One, there was hemorrhage, and two, the patients were having fevers, and they were dying very quickly. So this is appropriately termed sort of the Ebola hemorrhagic fever. And in case you're wondering where the name came from, nearby one of the towns was actually the river of Ebola, which was a tributary of the Congo River. And I joke that, you know, probably tourism has never quite been the same since. So what's, I think, startling since the initial outbreak, you know, almost 40 years ago, is that there have actually been a dozen outbreaks since then, at least a dozen. And there have been about 1,500, almost 1,600 deaths. So, you know, so unfortunately, one would expect, you know, there would have, something to have happened as a consequence of those previous outbreaks. Unfortunately, there hasn't been much. There are a paucity of experts in Ebola virus disease. There's a lack of published literature on Ebola virus disease. There's little to no, until recently, clinical or basic research. And actually, I would argue that there's been very, very, very poor efforts at large syndromic surveillance around Ebola virus disease. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Liberia sort of as an example. And I'm going to tell you a bit of a story of Liberia to give you a, you know, to characterize the sociocultural fabric, what was going on in Liberia before Ebola hit, because that's really important in understanding why the Ebola outbreak sort of took off. And for those of you who are a little more sort of savvy in the details about the Ebola outbreak, you're probably saying, well, it actually didn't start in Liberia. It actually started, you know, in Guinea or in Sierra Leone. And yeah, it did, but the cases were so trivial, but it's when it hit Liberia that things got really out of control. Liberia, as you may know, is a West African nation. It's sandwiched by Sierra Leone and Guinea and the Ivory Coast over to the east. And Liberia has the dubious distinction of having been involved in two really nasty civil wars. The first was the late 80s to early 90s, and then the second was in the late 90s to early 2000. In the first civil war, Liberia, 1 in 17 Liberians died. It was mass genocide. There was a lot of, unease. There were a lot of, I think, particularly sort of scary things happening, such as the use of children in warfare. Anyway, a few years after that, the second civil war erupted. And the culmination of the two was, unfortunately, the disruption of, deep disruption of the civil fabric, the economic system, the healthcare system, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But in 2006, Ellen Sirleaf Johnson, became the president, and then she was reelected a few years after that to serve her a second term, and really did, I think, wonders for the country in helping to heal. However, in post-conflict Liberia, there's still, as of 2012 at least, quite concerning statistics. So the population of Liberia about then was about 4.2 million. Per capita income and expenditure on healthcare per capita were low, probably not terribly different than many other West African countries. However, what's especially startling is the position to population ratio. Sort of especially wide, 1 in 76,000. So, you know, the WHO goals are recommended about 1 in 1,000. The leading causes of mortality in Liberia before Ebola hit was malaria, lower respiratory tract infections, diarrheal illnesses, HIV/AIDS, TB. Again, not wildly different than most other sub-Saharan African nations. However, as a result of the civil war, we see that there's an extremely sort of fragile socioeconomic system in Liberia. The healthcare system was terribly fragmented. As I demonstrated, very few healthcare providers. And the provision of frontline healthcare facilities and care was seriously lacking. Emergency care was severely underdeveloped, both in the in-hospital and pre-hospital setting. There's virtually non-existent pre-hospital transportation. You'll see why that's significant later on. There's no syndromic or contagious infectious disease surveillance. And in general, there's just this, when you talk to people who spend a lot of time in Liberia, they tell you there's just this pervasive skepticism of authority in the healthcare system. Similar to many other sub-Saharan African countries, a lot of folks with a lot of traditional beliefs perhaps don't want to go to healthcare facilities due to traditional practices and so on. But this is especially magnified in Liberia. So I'll fast forward to day one. And I'll take you to Bong County, which is one of the 12 counties in Liberia. And Bong County has a population of about 220,000 people. And Phoebe Hospital, small, actually one of only two or three small hospitals with a few inpatient beds. Patient walks in with a fever, body aches, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, not unlike many other patients they've seen before, with what sounds just like malaria. So a team of five nurses and one physician care for this patient. And a few days later, the patient would die. The healthcare providers would get sick and themselves come down with the same symptoms and subsequently die. The Bong County health officials, sort of recognizing something odd was going on, sent samples out for testing and came back as Ebola virus. And so at that point, sort of the alert was out. There was an Ebola virus outbreak in Bong County. And remember, a couple of weeks to months before, this had happened in other communities and other countries nearby. So as a result, sort of hysteria and pandemonium set in, healthcare providers die. Those who didn't sort of fled. There were empty beds, empty waiting areas, and if you've been in healthcare settings in sub-Saharan Africa, this is a rare sight. There was essentially no delivery of any acute or inpatient care. Clinics and hospitals closed. The international NGOs, who are really the backbone of this healing and growing Liberian system, fled. The Ministry of Health effectively shuts down. And the healthcare system in Bong County is crippled. And as a result of that, there's an inability to contain the sort of really the first, almost large-scale outbreak in any African, sub-Saharan African community. And so we see that Ebola essentially jumps out of Bong County to nearby counties and skips borders. And this, I think, is the real beginning of the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. So I'll contrast this experience in Liberia with what happened in Nigeria. So in I think late July, Mr. Patrick Sawyer, who was a Liberian resident, his sister died of symptoms that are very consistent with Ebola. Realizing he was infected and realizing his own mortality, and the fact that there was essentially no healthcare infrastructure to care for him, he decided to go to Lagos in Nigeria to seek, not medical care, but actually to seek care of traditional, sort of, there's a pastor who was sort of trying to heal people. So he jumps on a plane, he heads to Lagos, and when he lands, his burden of disease is so large that he's sort of too ill, and he's taken to a healthcare facility. So this First Consultants Hospital. And he would be cared for there by a physician who I think was quite astute in realizing the similarity of his symptoms with those from others who had died from Ebola. She subsequently sort of alerted the Nigerian healthcare authorities, who acted very swiftly in implementing sort of hospital-based preventative measures. We were also quick at doing case tracing of all the folks this gentleman had been around or in contact with. And as a result of this very sort of prompt and aggressive effort by the Nigerian by the Nigerian government, they were able to contain Ebola, I think, fairly quickly. And since the initial episode, there actually have not been, for months, any more cases or deaths in Nigeria. So Dr. Stella would be hailed as sort of a hero. I think, you know, the synergy of her efforts and the Nigerian Ministry of Health acting promptly, you know, sort of, I think, are to be commended. Unfortunately, Dr. Stella would die a few days later after caring for this patient herself. So, and that example is just to allow you to contrast the difference between sort of a fragile, you know, very fragile sort of crippled healthcare system from one that was a little more robust and able to respond a little more aggressively, and what the difference in trajectory of, you know, of the national outbreak have been. Liberia being quite devastating and Nigeria being, I think, fairly minimal. So what is the toll on West Africa in general then? So this was the 31st October report, so about, you know, 3.5 weeks ago from the WHO. About 13,500 cases, this is all comers, almost 5,000 deaths, and about 500 healthcare worker cases, of which 269 died. And I think just from looking at those numbers alone, you realize very quickly that there's a disproportionate effect on healthcare workers, you know, given the general population size. The 21st November report, so again, this is just, you know, 3 weeks after that report, show that there are now 15,300 cases, which is an increase of 11% in 3 weeks. 5,500 cases, an increase in deaths, 9% of deaths. And healthcare workers, about a proportional increase. And what this says to me is that healthcare workers are perhaps still not being adequately protected, and maybe even educated and informed. If you look specifically at the breakdown of these deaths, you'll see that Liberia bears the brunt of this, even though it has a fairly tiny population, 4.2 million people. I've highlighted Mali just because I'm sure you're all aware that there's now sort of, there have been a few more deaths in Mali. Actually, there have been 6 cases and 6 deaths. I'm sorry, is your hand up? I'm sorry. And I'll show you, this map actually is from the WHO. That sort of shows all the hotspots of the outbreak. Liberia, so in red is where Bong County is. And then around that, as you can see, there's Guinea and there's Sierra Leone. And then Mali is actually all the way up to the northeast corner. And that little sort of tiny yellow spot is Bamako, which is the capital, where the 6 cases have been. So there's actually ongoing active tracing of cases. I think there are about 320 cases that are being traced. So we'll sort of keep a close eye on that, but that has the potential to sort of, you know, spread Ebola further inland and eastward. So a couple of weeks ago, the CDC was really concerned and estimating that 500,000 people could be affected by Ebola in January 2015 if there was no swift and aggressive sort of international attention and response to this. I think there has been. And actually, this quote, I think, is from probably a few months ago. And I think it's clear to see that, you know, the trajectory of Ebola is not on that devastating path anymore. However, there's still a large potential for regional and global spread. So, sort of a really critical point that I like to make is, you know, is Ebola is really a disease of healthcare systems, where I think the vulnerability of these healthcare systems, plus the insult that Ebola confers, has resulted in a critical failure or critical injury of these healthcare systems. And we'll get back to this concept. I want to plant this seed in your mind now. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about Ebola virus disease. And I realize that, you know, in a way, I think of all of you as, you know, sort of the brave few who've managed to survive Ebola media fatigue. So I'm sure you've received a lot of this information in the past. So just indulge me again, for those of you who may not have. So anybody know what this is?
Bat?
Yeah, that's a bat. It's actually a fruit bat. I don't know if it's really cute or really ugly, but nonetheless, this little guy over here is sort of one of the well-known natural reservoirs and hosts of the Ebola virus. And Ebola typically lives in, you know, sort of in an animal population. It cycles through bats, and every once in a while will jump out into primates. And then what happens is humans get into contact with these infected sort of wildlife. In sub-Saharan Africa, especially through consuming animal products, animal meats, most of which are dried or sort of minimally cooked. And that's the hypothesis. It's not quite known how Ebola jumped out of the animal into the human sort of species, but that's sort of the most likely hypothesis. Why? Because the same thing happens in the Congo every few years, and it's, I think, fairly well known and studied. So I'll tell you a little bit about the Ebola virus. It's a rod. It's a rod RNA, single strand RNA virus of the family Filoviridae. Now there are actually five different types of sort of Ebola viruses, if you will. But I won't get into that. But the Zaire virus is actually one of the most sort of infectious and deadly. And nonetheless, they're all characterized by this lipoprotein envelope. And that's particularly significant because, you know, the lipoprotein envelope contains some human-like, you know, proteins that allow it to be particularly infectious in human species. And also, I think the coat confers it a little bit of hardiness, so it can survive some semi-harsh environments that most viruses wouldn't be able to. And this I think, is quite important, and it's how transmissible it can be. So Ebola, once it makes its way into the human bloodstream, infects monocytes. This results in a large sort of cytokine or inflammatory response in the body. And as a result of that inflammatory response, cells that line, you know, membranes and blood vessels, for example, become leaky. They bleed. People lose fluids internally. You know, there is bleeding at mucous membranes, and a result of sort of the aggregate effect of all this is that patients, you know, get hypotensive, where their blood volume goes low, they go into multi-organ sort of failure, and they die. And some patients hemorrhage to death, but that's a very small subset. And unfortunately, Ebola doesn't really discriminate between organs because of that mechanism. And so there's essentially an effect on every organ system. Symptoms include things like constitutional symptoms like fevers, body aches. Patients have diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, rashes, and there can be blisters, bloody blisters on the skin and the mucous membranes around the mouth, for example. Patients get short of breath, they bleed internally in their lungs, get short of breath, cough blood. There's a pretty well-done New England Journal article that has compiled, you know, all the symptoms and a lot of data from the current Ebola outbreak. And so these data are going to come from that article. Symptoms include fevers, it's the most common, fatigue, loss of appetite, you know, a lot of things that if you've, speaking from somebody who's had, you know, malaria half a dozen times, these are exactly malaria symptoms. They're also exactly flu, you know, flu-like symptoms. So very nonspecific and actually quite scary thinking about, you know, preparedness and surveillance. Ebola virus disease is an often fatal disease. The case fatality rate historically has been anywhere from 25 to 90%. But if you do the math from this specific West African outbreak, it's around 36%. And I explained already how the host jumps from animal to human species through handling by humans. But more importantly, human-to-human transmission, this time I think is especially important, has been the reason Ebola has blown up in West Africa. Mostly through bodily secretions, fluids, handling of organs. And Ebola goes through, you know, any mucous membrane or any break in the skin, and that's how somebody gets infected. The virus incubates a mean of about 5 days, but the range is 2 to 21 days, and actually can live in 61 days in semen. It's pretty interesting. It can survive in days in puddles and up to weeks in corpses. As the disease progresses, the patient or the victim become more infectious, such that early on when they have no symptoms, they are essentially non-infectious. And this is a really critical point for understanding, especially for disseminating to the population to understand, to allow people to understand when a patient is infectious or not. Early in disease, there's low infectivity. Late in disease, there's really high infectivity. And actually, it turns out that when somebody dies, that's when they're the highest in terms of infectivity.
Yes. Yeah, is there any data or knowledge about pregnant women who are infected? Are they more apt to die, or?
Yeah, good question. I have no idea. I haven't come across that anywhere.
I wondered if a pregnant woman has survived, if the virus went transplacentally to the fetus.
Yeah, good question. I don't know.
Okay.
My sense is, the case fatality rate is quite high. I don't know that there were many pregnant women to live to tell. Good question. No idea. I would be even more interested to know if the pregnant woman survived, if her fetus became sort of immune.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And hemorrhage, everybody talks about bleeding from Ebola, but it turns out it's only there in about 18% of cases. And this information is that's now sort of being published. But the medical director of one of the Ebola treatment centers, who I was with in Ethiopia 2 weeks ago, was telling me that they've studied this, and it's only in about 18% of their cases. So it's not that common symptom. And they find that it's more so the site of IV, where they place IVs and the patient mucous membranes. But however, what they did realize is that it's a high predictor of a patient who's going to die. So at highest risk of contracting Ebola are really those who care for patients, so for example, family members at home, and healthcare workers. And then I think of particular mention are those who handle deceased remains. Unfortunately, it's a sort of a fairly common practice in many sub-Saharan African communities, where, especially Muslim communities, where the remains of the deceased are sort of, the family's property, and it's a source of pride to sort of care for your dead relative, wash them, bathe them, dress them, and then bury them. You guys may have heard that in Mali, the patient who died recently was an imam, so sort of a high priest, a Muslim priest. And part of the culture is you touch the body of the deceased before they are buried. And so this happened, and as a result, there were 388 folks who are now being traced, who all came into contact with this corpse. So there's, again, sociocultural issues that perpetuate the transmission. So also important to know how one can actually kill Ebola virus disease. And you can do this in a variety of ways. I mean, you can use the caustic agents like bleach, peroxide. But actually, heating turns out to be sort of fairly effective. 60 degrees Celsius for 60 minutes, a little hotter for about 30 minutes, or you can just submerge the infected material in boiling water for 5 minutes. Obviously, not applicable to humans. So back to this concept that I raised earlier about the vulnerability, the insult, and the critical injury being inflicted. So to sort of flesh that out, the vulnerability really comes from, and especially, again, think about Liberia. While I use Liberia as a case, it's not the history of many of these West African countries are not dissimilar. Most have been through at least one episode of civil war in the last 2 to 3 decades of building their fragmented, poorly resourced healthcare system. So it's not, I paint that story just as an example. So again, fragile sort of social and cultural healthcare, settings, very limited healthcare workers, a huge vulnerability. Most at risk are the healthcare workers, the folks you need to respond and take care of patients who have been affected. Poor resources and infrastructure, the lack of syndromic surveillance, I think a huge problem. And then in general, just a sort of pervasively, there's really no disaster emergency preparedness. So the insult, as we all know, was this really highly infectious and transmissible virus. And this time, again, what was different about this outbreak than historically the 12 other outbreaks? So this occurred in sort of a larger, sort of more suburban, urban community. I told you the story of why the initial efforts at containing Ebola in Bong County, Liberia failed. And I think this was a huge, you know, this was a huge reason Ebola really made its way out into West Africa. And then, just in general, I think the fear and panic among the healthcare workers and the non-governmental organizations who promptly fled. And these folks were a really critical backbone of the healthcare infrastructure in Liberia. And so it really left them hanging in their most desperate time of need. So the critical injury subsequently was the deaths of healthcare workers. So now who's going to take care of all these patients? The absence of these NGOs, stigmatization of hospitals. This is a big, big issue. Patients who are already sort of mistrustful and, you know, have cultural predispositions to not want to seek care in a formal sort of a healthcare facility. And now they hear, you know, there's Ebola breaking out. This is where people go to die. No way. I'm not going to show up. Okay. So there's a big stigmatization of healthcare workers and hospitals. This is actually particularly bad for the healthcare workers. A lot of them were scared to go back into their communities. They were feeling ostracized. And then the culmination of all these is really that the healthcare systems were, you know, really crippled. So, you know, I think Ebola disease really exposed the vulnerability of these fragile, unprepared, and under-resourced African healthcare and emergency care systems. I think for me, that is the crux of really what Ebola has done. So, you know, you can look at this in a sort of a half cup full, you know, empty. I try and look at the optimistic side. Damage is sort of being done. So what can we do? Where are the opportunities to really curtail the epidemic? So there are a couple of things, and I described all these for you previously, but I'll point them out again. So the fact that the mean time to symptom onset is about 5 days means you have a window. You have a window to intervene, to find somebody, and to isolate them if they've been sort of exposed to somebody who's a case. And that allows you to quarantine and observe them. And previous outbreaks, especially in Central Africa, have shown that actually the Ebola transmission can actually be very, very quickly interrupted, and if you can decrease the case incidence by 50%, usually this can be done in 2 to 3 weeks, you can essentially stamp out Ebola in a month or two, as what evidence from and data from other, especially from Congo, says. A few other opportunities. I think for healthcare workers especially, it's simple personal protective equipment to protect you against, a patient who may have Ebola. There's an opportunity to enforce simple hand washing practices. And luckily, bleach is actually very, very commonly available in many healthcare systems. It's quite cheap. And a 1 in 10 part bleach solution is quite effective at eradicating viruses on surfaces and even on dead remains. Unfortunately, what I don't tell you here is you actually require the data from Ebola treatment units say that you need 70 liters of bleach for every one patient who has Ebola, and that's over the course of the treatment, so it's quite a lot. But again, this is, a fairly readily available chemical. And another opportunity is the fact that the treatment of Ebola, there's no miracle drug as yet, the treatment of Ebola is really basic resuscitative care to support whatever organ system is failing or doing poorly, and to resuscitate patients with basic intravenous fluids and optimize their nutritional status if possible. And then I think the last very sort of cool opportunity is the fact that survivors are actually conferred immunity. And there's actually in 1 or 2 treatment centers in Liberia, they're actually repatriating these folks back in to the healthcare centers to help take care of patients. I think that's a great idea. Yeah. So other opportunities, I think large opportunities around community education, especially around safe burial practices. And the message is getting out into the communities, but unfortunately evidenced by what happened in Mali, clearly the message hasn't gone far enough. There are also opportunities to strengthen border surveillance, and this has happened where borders have been sort of shut down. I don't know that closing borders is a good idea. Because we know, especially in, if you've seen any of these borders, I mean, you're standing at a gate and you look, a mile down the street and it's just, there's nothing. Anybody can just kind of walk over. And historically, there are large sort of migrant populations who just cross these borders. So border control alone is not an effective strategy on its own. And then I think there have been opportunities and there have been actions around enforcing local travel bans and restrictions. And I think some of these are appropriate. I think banning international sort of travel is a little crazy for many different reasons, but some of these effect. I think again, all these various combinations of these strategies, I think are fairly smart and and effective. So unfortunately, there's no one simple strategy. This is a complex, multifaceted, both humanitarian and healthcare system problem. So the CDC recommends sort of three main strategies. And for those of you who, you know, who do any sort of work around pandemics or infection control, you know, this is not novel or exciting, but essentially finding patients or cases, responding to those who may have been infected, caring for them, especially their contacts, and then preventing new cases. So sort of a three-pronged approach. And what I like about this is it acknowledges both preventing cases in healthcare settings and sort of in the general population. So I'm going to sort of describe to you hallmarks of the local response in at least three of the four affected countries right now. They all seem to be doing at least some version of you know, all of these steps. And all of these link back into the three things I just showed you before, but these are presented in a slightly different order. So the first is to improve syndromic surveillance. And I mentioned already that these systems are severely lacking. So in the U.S., it would happen something where, like, a, a higher resource setting, it would happen something where, like, where data, electronic data and healthcare charts, would automatically go to a, a healthcare agency, either the state or the government level, who would collate these data and, disseminate results and say, hey, look, we think, there's been a spike of flu-like symptoms, in Denver or whatever. And as a result, there would be some action. And as you can tell, that requires some sort of high level of infrastructure and communication and so on. And unfortunately, in many sub-Saharan African settings, that those sophisticated mechanisms don't quite exist. And so, four Sierra Leonean physicians in the Lancet published a statement, a really nice paper actually, about what they needed. And one of the statements they made was that mobile technologies can offer early warning systems, response to outbreaks, and communication among doctors and local officials on the scene and international health authorities. This is specific to Ebola. So what they're asking for is to use cell phones. mHealth is all the the rage now in sub-Saharan Africa. Actually, I know low income settings globally. And people are really savvy and use these phones a lot. And so what they're asking for is a way to link their cell phones to be able to send simple data about cases or about patients who have Ebola-like symptoms to sort of geographic, sort of free, open platforms such as this. So unfortunately, this, I think this is really cool. This health map site is really cool, but unfortunately, there's no way the docs, on the ground, in the affected countries have no access to technology like this. So this is being sort of, this is a work in progress. As from what I've heard as of a few weeks ago, there's been no real success or broad implementation of any system like this, but I think this is going to happen. And for those of us who build emergency care systems, the prospect of something like this happens is really exciting. So what else has been happening? I think secondly, there's been a lot of strengthening of hospital-based preparedness. Unfortunately, I think this is too late. This should have come, years ago, but nonetheless, you see the opportunity here. So what's been happening is the ministries of, health in various countries, even countries that have not been hit by Ebola, partnering with sort of international folks and authorities like the UN MIR team and the WHO to, who bring in infrastructure and resources and some technology, and as a result, sort of helping local facilities be better prepared for dealing with the current epidemic and hopefully with subsequent outbreaks. And there have been a few, I think, critical components to getting hospitals prepared to deal with the current patients. One is, like I mentioned before, basic infection prevention and control measures. The second is around screening and isolation. This is really important. So one, I think, very cool intervention, which makes total sense, especially in a low-resource environment. So when patients come in through the door, there's no contact between healthcare providers, especially nurses who do screening, and these patients. It's actually a table, and the providers sit on one end, and the patients sit on one end, and they're separated by about 1 meter, which is about 3 feet. The rationale for this is, the patients are not coming in, masked, and if they cough, usually droplets will travel about 3 feet. However, the healthcare provider at the other end has a mask on and, goggles and a face mask, and they have some as a simple personal protective care equipment. And then, you know, so they do their history and sort of, you know, ask the person very high yield screening questions like, have you been in, you know, in contact with a case of Ebola? When was it? Sort of trying to get at whether it was within the last 21 days and so on. And then, you know, they use these infrared, no contact infrared sensors to, you know, to do screening to see if patients have febrile. Again, you know, this is not cheap, you know, to have this piece of equipment. And that's why I think the partnership with, you know, teams like UNMIR and WHO are important. This is just a general lack of personal protective equipment. So when Joe and I were in, you know, Ghana 2 months ago, we were doing this disaster preparedness train the trainers course. You know, we had some folks come, contribute. Some of the Ghanaian docs come contribute what they learned in the Congo about Ebola preparedness, and you know, they're telling us that one of the big issues is there's just no hospitals, and they themselves, the docs, just don't have any personal protective care equipment. Gloves, fine, but obviously there's a lot more that goes into protecting yourself. And I think this has been this is what a lot of international groups have really been able to contribute, even if they haven't been able to send people down, they've been able to send over some sort of basic PPE. And then having a dedicated, specially trained Ebola response team, really important. We know that sort of what we call donning and doffing, so putting on and taking off the personal protective equipment. It can be, if you don't do it every day often, I mean, it's a skill. And if you don't, and if you're sloppy or if you're just poorly trained or inexperienced, chances are high you're going to infect yourself. The rationale is, well, better to have, if you have a patient who shows up at your facility who has Ebola-like symptoms, instead of just having sort of the usual care team show and take care of them, we'll activate a specially trained team, who know how to do this and know how to do it well. And the same principle many facilities in the U.S. are using. So this exists in many healthcare systems is what we're hearing. And then, of course, I think there must be hospitals are often called to say, hey, there's a patient, you know, in this house, whatever, a few communities down, who has Ebola, you know, everybody's like, they have Ebola. So how are we going to get them to the healthcare facility? Well, you need some form of transport, a specialized transport, you know, where you can clean the vehicle when you're done and, you know, the healthcare providers, all protected. So that's been another sort of large thrust of local Ebola efforts. So Ebola treatment units, really sort of important. And again, keeping in mind that the existing facilities are too crowded, under-resourced, you know, just don't have the capacity. I mean, they already are overwhelmed dealing with sort of non-Ebola patients. So I think to throw an Ebola patient into the mix where they would infect many other people, be inadequately cared for, it's a terrible idea. So I think there's value to building these Ebola treatment units. The question I have afterwards is, well, what's going to happen to them and how are these going to be integrated into the larger healthcare systems and be used for other, you know, initiatives? So groups like WHO, Medecins Sans Frontières, IMC, the United Nations Group, and the Cuban physicians actually, the Cubans actually have been great. They've sent a ton of physicians down to West Africa. How many people knew about that? Yeah, pretty cool. Yeah. So the Ebola treatment units have several components, but I think the three most mentionable or worthy of mention are sort of screening and triage areas to be able to sort of sort out, you know, who is a probable probable case or a low risk case, or who is, you know, definitely a high risk or, you know, a most likely infectious case. And then observation or isolation units for patients who are low risk, and treatment wards or units for patients who are, you know, confirmed cases. And the Medecins Sans Frontières, you saw the schematic of their generic Ebola clinic, looks something like this. And I think the simplest way to, you know, sort of break this down is that with the solid red dots are just tents where they have, just tents for suspected Ebola patients. And then the dot with the bullseye is where, you know, where they house the confirmed patients. And then there's, you know, separate entrances, for patients, you know, who are sort of higher risk from lower risk, and then there's a way to obviously separate, the healthcare providers, from the patient. So it's all very sort of compartmentalized. And this is just an example of one of those structures. It looks like there's an orientation a couple of months ago in Liberia. So the fourth sort of response has actually been to improve access to diagnostic technologies. And a lot of people are like, ah, they need more equipment to be able to diagnose and test for Ebola, thinking about PCR and ELISA. Actually, that's not the biggest need. That's important too. And a lot of folks, experts, have advocated for, instead of sending one of, you know, these are actually quite expensive and involved tests, instead of sending them to each healthcare facility, actually have them on a regional basis. So people can send in samples of you know, suspected cases to be tested for Ebola. But actually, in the local healthcare facilities, what's really needed is the ability to just do basic testing. Remember, there's a high, you know, the burden of disease from malaria is high. Patients are really anemic at baseline, you know, in sub-Saharan Africa compared to, for example, the U.S. You know, so knowing what a patient's, you know, blood count looks like, knowing what their basic chemistries look like, especially a patient who's having fever, who's losing a lot of, who has large and sensible losses, or who's having a lot of diarrhea, and you know, whose potassium level may be low. These patients could be dying from other very simple, sort of fixable issues. So there's been a large push to provide basic, you know, sort of point of care screening equipment to just to be able to provide good care to patients. So a fifth hallmark has really been in these communities. The governments have been really aggressive about educating the public. As you can imagine, you know, a lot of false stereotypes about how Ebola spread, even in the U.S., right? Even among healthcare providers in the U.S. So I think the, you know, the push for communications is absolutely essential. But telling folks, especially something like, you know, when you meet a dead body in the street, don't touch it. You just leave it. Call the health officials, we'll take care of it. And I think that's kind of what this patient is showing. It's kind of a line, you know, where there's no line drawn or written, but everybody, it seems to be this invisible line that everybody's standing behind, right? Recognizing that, hey, let's keep our distance, right? This is something infectious. And I think, secondly, the other important message that's coming across is if you're sick, go to a healthcare facility. Don't stay at home. Isolate yourself from other people and go to a healthcare facility. Unfortunately, what's missing is, well, how do I get there, right? Patients don't have the resources. You got to jump in a taxi or take public transport. So, not easy problems to fix. And then contact tracing, which I've described earlier, really important to be able to. And I'll show you a little schematic. So this is for the CDC. An example goes something like, you know, so you're carrying, you have a patient in your facility who is an Ebola case. Essentially, you want to ask that patient about, you know, the names and locations of all the folks they've been in contact with. Go grab those folks and sort them out. Folks who are obviously sick, who look like they have Ebola, you take care of them, you ask them the questions, and you go out and find all the folks they've been in touch with. And you keep doing that until you have no more new people. Towards the right, the very right is, well, actually, the dark figure shows that if, you know, if you grab a case of somebody who's, or not a case, but somebody who's been exposed to a patient with confirmed Ebola, you watch them. You watch them for 21 days, and if they have no symptoms, then their risk of essentially coming down with Ebola is virtually nil. Okay. And unfortunately, the scariest part of contact tracing is knowing that you're going to miss some people, or not being able to find these people, right, because they don't have addresses, and you know, their cell phone chips, their SIM cards are not registered, and you know, you just have social security numbers, you just don't know where to find them. So they're out there getting in touch with other people, and you don't know if they're infectious and if they're transmitting Ebola. It's very scary. Yeah. And so what you ultimately want to happen is obviously to be able to, you know, all the cases, you know, you've traced, to be able to talk to them and observe them and treat them and release them and know that there are no new cases out there. So the seventh hallmark of the local response has been safe burials. Remember I described to you how, again, it's very common traditional practice for families, you know, to handle the bodies of their relatives. And so this has been a huge sort of paradigm shift, and it's not happening as much as folks would like. But they don't want families touching their bodies. The bodies are put in, you know, so these plastic, you know, bags, and the healthcare providers of the team, the burial teams, are fully clad in their PPE, and they go to bury. So the last time I did this 2 weeks ago, and I did the smaller version of this talk, the Global Health Course, somebody asked me, well, what happens, to the body in the ground and the body bag. I have no idea. Those things are not, they're not bio-friendly. They don't disintegrate, and we know that actually after a couple of months, Ebola virus in a float on a body will no longer exist. So I think that's a pretty sound, sound rationale. You zip them up in something that's not going to disintegrate for decades, knowing that the virus will sort of outlive its life, in a few months. The most. The problem is if you have a dog sort of digging through this and, unhurts a body. But anyway, it's nonetheless, I think, a pretty savvy and solid intervention. So the last has really to be to improve safe transportation for probable or confirmed cases. And I won't sort of belabor this point, but there has been a huge push now. Sort of every week I'm getting sort of emails that say, hey, do you know anybody who has older ambulances to donate? Because they need safe ways of getting these patients, from their homes or the scene into a, Ebola treatment unit or a healthcare facility without contaminating everybody along the way. So there's a very cool video online on YouTube actually about this, about one of the Liberian Ebola sort of ambulance. It's very, very, very touching. And the story is from the perspective of the driver, who had a family and four kids and essentially sent his family and his kids to go live in another town. And all he does is, about 18 hours a day is run around town, trying to, responding to calls of, probable cases. And very sad stories of getting there, going through the whole process of exposing his healthcare provider team to this patient, isolating the patient, getting him in the back of the ambulance, going to a treatment unit only to be turned away because there's no room for the patient. Go to another healthcare facility, the same thing. Ultimately, they come back, they drop the patient off at their home, and the patient dies. Yeah, this is a really common story. And again, there's only so much capacity to develop these, treatment units and to build the healthcare facilities to improve their capacity to be able to care for these patients. I remember while Ebola is going on, already, healthcare facilities are full of other patients, suffering from all the other diseases we talked about in the beginning. So the real question is whether the Ebola outbreak is being halted. If you look at the report from the WHO put out at the end of October, somewhere in there was the language of sounding like, oh yeah, things are starting to sort of slow down and we feel like we have a handle on this and so on. However, if you look at the numbers that I threw up, recently at the beginning of the presentation, 11% increase in the last 3 weeks. That's startling to me for something that's been going on for about, 7 months now, 8 months now. So I don't know. I feel like all of a sudden there's a blip, there's an upward blip in terms of sort of new cases. So the data from the November 21st report, there definitely is an increase, and I think an alarming increase in the number of cases. And I think even more alarming is now we're seeing cases in a new country. And remember, these are places where surveillance mechanisms are quite poor. And so anytime I hear a number, 50 cases, I think the real number to me is probably five times that many. It's just people I'm presenting to healthcare facilities, and there's no way of being able to reach out and grab all these, and identify all these cases. So I don't know. I was quite optimistic 3 weeks ago. Now I have my questions as to whether or not, where the trajectory is headed. However, what I think we can all confidently say is this is not headed to that 500,000 cases that the CDC predicted. That was just absolutely scary. So to conclude, there are deep, deep sociocultural roots for why one Ebola started in West Africa, where usually it's a Central African issue, and why it took off, really this time because it was in an urban, crowded area, and all the practices, the sociocultural, traditional practices that allowed Ebola to, sort of magnify and spread. That's all fairly new. That really hasn't happened like that before in the history of Ebola. Secondly, the outbreak has really been exacerbated by these very unprepared and fragmented healthcare systems which, I spent a lot of time trying to fix, and a lot of people do. Like I said before, Ebola has really exposed, these fragile, fragmented systems. However, it can be contained with a planned approach, and we're seeing that happen now over the last few months. Unfortunately or fortunately, assistance from the international community is really key in this. But again, from somebody who you know, sort of as an advocate and a champion of this sort of work. I think it's really what Ebola virus disease has done is really emphasize the importance of healthcare system preparedness and also partnerships in global health to try to address issues like this and many other sort of disasters in healthcare that occur every day in sub-Saharan Africa. So I'm trying not to paint a totally bleak, you know, story. I think there is a lot of good work that's been done, and I'm really glad to see that we're not at that 500,000 mark, and we're only down at sort of the 10,000 to 20,000 case range. So with that, I'll stop here. It was a long one. I'm happy to take any questions and engage, and I hope that this was informative from a slightly different perspective, that of, you know, somebody who's sort of, you know, lived, you know, in West Africa for 20 years and still spends a lot of time sort of engaged in you know, the communities and the work around emergency care system development. So, questions?
You first defined, I believe, in Sierra Leone, there were 6,000 people, and then death rate was 2. So it's a much lower death rate than, and I didn't know if there was a reason. Is there a social reason, or is there a...
Yeah, so I talked to some folks about this recently, and we just think it's poor surveillance. And patients aren't going to facilities. Outside of that, I'm not sure. Yeah.
Did you hear recently, I just heard this yesterday, that our university has decided that if anybody goes over to volunteer, that you cannot practice for 3 weeks after you get back?
Yeah.
Did you hear about that?
I thought this has been around for a while.
Go to clinical. We had a student who was going to go over Christmas break, and they won't be allowed to go to clinical.
But I think that makes perfect sense.
Do you?
Yeah, I do. I mean, right, if you come into contact with... there are a couple of things, right? So you never know for sure whether you've been in contact with somebody who had, you know, Ebola virus disease because of malaria and all these other issues. So in the course of routine work, it's tough to say if somebody you were exposed to who was febrile was a, you know, a known case. With that said, if a student or a healthcare worker, you know, comes back, they've been around a bunch of sick patients in a healthcare setting, especially if they've been working in an Ebola treatment unit, the standard of practice for Medecins Sans Frontières, for the WHO, for all these other groups, is to, you have mandatory isolation for 3 weeks. Yeah. I think that makes, to me, that makes sense. Yeah.
Although we have a hard time, the U.S. people, maintaining that 3 weeks. I wonder if there's any progress.
So, in the small hospitals, I can't comment on those, I just don't know. But in the Ebola treatment units and at the large government hospitals, you are under, when you go in, so if you volunteer, for example, with Medecins Sans Frontières, so Doctors Without Borders, your contract states that you have a mandatory 3-week isolation, you know, after you care for these patients. And the same thing happens in some of the large government hospitals that are dedicated to caring for Ebola in the Ebola treatment units. So I think from a biologically or from a pathophysiologic perspective, I think it makes sense. It sucks. I mean, who's going to pay for that time, especially for the healthcare provider in the U.S., you know? I mean, so there are all sorts of complications, but from a public health perspective, I think it makes sense. Yeah, and you shouldn't be isolated in the U.S., you should be isolated in the country where you, where you are working. Yeah.
Can you say a little bit more on the diagnostics and how early can you diagnose cases with
this lag? Yeah, sure. I don't think it's been well studied yet. But if you're afebrile, your viral load, if you're afebrile within those sort of first 5 days and have no symptoms, your viral load is so low. You're virtually not infectious, and two, the sensitivity of the test in picking up a patient like that actually is quite poor. I've been told when, and I actually deleted a slide I had about PCR and ELISA, I just thought it was too much.
But when you start being infectious and the viral load rises, some of the tests are actually a lot more positive. So there are a couple of cases recently where folks knew they were in contact with people who had Ebola. They tested them, and they were negative. Isolated them, kept them anyway, retested them, and they came back positive. One case was released into the community by mistake, but this was months ago. Yeah, so... So I don't remember specifically the sensitivity and specificity, and I don't think it's been worked out based on sort of days and with viral load. I'm sure they're working on those data now. To answer your question? Yes, sir.
Can you elaborate a little bit more on the coordination, the logistical coordination between healthcare workers and non-healthcare workers that is in place and what the prospects are for coordination and transportation, government? Government workers and even foreign aid through military assistance or some kind like that.
Yeah, sure. So I think the best example I can give you is from the UN MIR team. I forget what MIR stands for, the Mission on Emergency Ebola Response. So the United Nations sort of has a team of several healthcare folks, you know, who actually set up headquarters in Accra, in Ghana. And you know they have several teams, country teams. And each team goes out, you know, to a respective country, you know, with a an aircraft, you know, a military aircraft, full of all the equipment, your vehicles, medical gear, and so on. And what they do when they show up is they set up shop and they partner with a specially dedicated team from the Ministry of Health. And what they do is then they start, you know, thinking about looking at the map of, you know, of Ebola sort of outbreaks, you know, in their country, deciding where they want to shift resources to, deciding who the dedicated teams are going to be, who are going to care for those patients with Ebola. Because those teams sort of are obviously higher risk for infection. And so those teams are sort of quadranted off from the general population a little bit more aggressively. Some of these Ebola treatment facilities have sort of a little makeshift housing next door where the physicians and healthcare providers stay for weeks at a time before, you know, and then are isolated before going back into the communities, back to the families and so on. So that's the most concrete sort of model I can give you. Outside of that, I can't really comment on sort of what sort of smaller healthcare facilities and private healthcare facilities are doing. In terms of protecting, I guess, the population from, you know, higher risk healthcare workers. I think the knowledge is getting out there that you must do something. And I like the idea of having special Ebola response teams. And again, these are mostly facilities that are not Ebola treatment units, just general hospitals where the providers are caring for, you know, dozens, hundreds of patients. You know, so you have a special team that responds if a patient shows up at your facility who is infected with Ebola. You know, they're high risk. And then you have just a smaller subset of your healthcare workers to have to worry about.
You seem to put a large emphasis, obviously, on making prompt action. So in regard to that, what international group do you think has the ability to make the largest effect in that regard? I'm thinking about UN, it could maybe take time and, you know, get country support and things like that. Would that be too little too late? I guess, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's funny you said the UN would take time. The response to setting up shop, like, on the ground, like in Ghana, has been the fastest response the UN has ever put together in history. And the order of days from the minute sort of the declaration was signed, in the order of days, they had a team on the ground with resources backing it up. So your question is who sort of responding to this or will have the longest lasting impact?
Yeah, I guess so.
Sure. Again, I think the UN MIR team, because again, what they're doing is they're trying to partner with the ministries of health to do two things. One, respond. You know, build these Ebola treatment units that will take care of these infected patients. But also, they're trying to get into the healthcare systems to help improve preparedness, distribute personal protective equipment, and so on. Now, again, that's, I think, still a band-aid on a deep underlying problem. So the real question you're asking is, how can these systems be improved, you know, to either, prevent or respond to maybe a future Ebola outbreak? And I think the response comes from sort of people who've already been doing this work, you know, for years now, people who show up and partner with folks on the ground and try and build sustainable, you know, sort of effective care systems. If I had the answer for that, I'd be on TED Talks or something. It's a larger, really important question, right? Because on one hand, philosophically, you just go in and sort of take care of patients who have Ebola, hope that those facilities will be used for some other goal when you leave, or do you get in and rather try and fix the underlying issues, and they're so grave, I don't think it's possible in a timely manner. So respond to the current outbreak, and then in parallel, hopefully there'll be a lot of interest and emphasis on repairing these damaged and fragmented healthcare systems.
Well, you said that percentage-wise, a lot of the healthcare workers and the healthcare providers, they were the ones who did catch the Ebola virus and did end up, the statistics for their fatality is percentage-wise similar, right, at the beginning?
The general population is, it's sort of now in the order of about 35%. Healthcare workers, 50%.
Right, so it's higher. So I'm saying that right now, is there a standard practice and standard equipment for protecting the healthcare workers? Because the articles I've read were pretty poorly written. However, they did say that at this moment, there really isn't a standard procedure or standard equipment for protecting healthcare providers. So,
is there one? No. So, for example, if you go to Ghana or Liberia, they've adopted the WHO standard. But in some settings in Sierra Leone, for example, they use the Medicine Sans Frontières, the Doctors Without Borders, standard. And they're all quite similar now. There were some growing pains in the first few months, where, for example, Medicine Sans Frontières said, all physicians had that some sort of face mask and neck coverage, and the WHO came out with some slightly laxed PPE where the neck was exposed, so everybody's evolved. But they're all pretty similar. I think everybody understands there must be full barrier. Systems are welcome to adopt whatever PPE they use. I don't think there's any, true standard. The WHO, I think, is a fair standard. CDC has their own recommendations, and so on.
So currently you believe that the procedures that's set by the CDC and these various different organizations are good enough, so to speak?
I think so. I think the Medicines Sans Frontières, sort of their approach, because they've been on the ground, in these communities for decades, and Medicines Sans Frontières were the only NGO who did not leave when Ebola. Actually, they recruited more folks to come in and work. So they've had the most experience on the ground dealing with this. And when you look at their protocols, they make sense. And the folks who I know who've headed the treatment units all say that they use their protocols and they make sense and they work for them. I think what's happening is some of the information and the policies being adopted on our end, I think, are a lot aggressive. In our hospital, we have these complete suits, what we call PAPRs, which I think are quite excessive. And if you don't use these on a frequent basis, they'll contaminate yourself, So, I think we don't need to worry about what's going on in the USN. I think just focusing on what's happening in West Africa, it sounds like people are protecting themselves adequately and, using, I think, I don't say evidence-based, but well-thought-out protocols from groups like, the WHO. Yeah, so no standard, but several examples are the models that work.
Okay.
Yeah. You know what the relationship is between the international organizations and the state governments? Who's actually making the policy and whether or not, who or UNMEER needs to acquiesce to state policy and protocols?
More like the other way around. At least from what I've heard, I haven't sat in any of these meetings. I've known people who have, and so the stories they tell me are, the technical team, from overseas comes in, the local team sits there, and they're like, tell us what we should do, and we will happily oblige and play along. Countries are desperate. I don't know that there's much sort of negotiation going on. It's really an aggressive sort of humanitarian response right now.
I just know the Nigeria's response. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons why they have a greater doctor-patient ratio, mm-hmm. their government response was a far more authoritarian and putting people under house arrest, essentially, the patients that they track down or the people that they contact.
I see what you're asking. Yeah. So that happened in Liberia as well, and that happened in Sierra Leone, and that severely backfired.
Yeah.
It made again, these are populations who are already very skeptical of, you know, authority. I mean, so to put people under house arrest, I mean, that was not good. I mean, I had pictures that I deleted, you know, that showed the riots that were happening. People were fleeing their communities. I mean, you don't want that to happen. You want that to be calm and people to follow instructions and show up to healthcare facilities. So I don't know that sort of you and me or any of these groups are advocating for you know, anything like house arrest. Maybe what you're getting at is, you know, if a patient shows up who doesn't want to be cared for after being diagnosed with Ebola and they want to leave, you know, what is the law, the rules and regulations around that? Yeah. So here's that. So there isn't, from what I know, at least from two different countries, there was no policy that's been written. However, one of the medical directors from the Ebola treatment camp was telling me that it was really easy for them. These patients, usually once they're sick, they're febrile, they're really dehydrated. I mean, they're not, you know, they'll maybe even slightly sort of medically psychotic, you know, they're not thinking quite right. So it was really easy. It was like, oh yeah, they're not, you know, just restrain them sort of against their will for medical reasons. I mean, I'm not saying that's a solution, but that's been happening. You know, one could easily argue that from a public health perspective, you know, especially if you're in a state of martial law like Liberia was, you know, yeah, well, you can do that. So you're protecting the public. I'm not saying it's good nor bad. I'm just saying that there is no policy from at least two countries what I know of. And healthcare providers are using the strategy of, you know, their patients are usually confused and not thinking right to restrain and keep them against their will for treatment. Yeah. All right. I think we've spilled over. Yeah, sure. Thank you all for your attention.